All right, good evening. Welcome to Button Down Fellowship. Thank God for all of you that are here. I'd like to thank God for Chuck visiting with us tonight. And we'll go ahead and dive into our study. Hopefully everybody has had a good day, had a good week. It's warmed up. When I made the comment on Sunday about it being very cold here, I had some people who were watching the video who watched from Maine. And he said it was minus 13 to where he was at. So in the hour cold, yeah, exactly. So he let me know about that, brother Lonnie Martin. He let me know about that. And I talked to brother Leonard and Raina Roundtree out of Ohio, and they told me it was 8 degrees there. So although we were freezing down here, it was very, very cold for them. So, but thank God it's warmed up down here for us. It's back to normal Florida weather. So we thank God for that. we thank God for just the ministry as we continue to go forward. We thank God. I thank God for all those people that follow online. Those people who are watching the live stream. We were able to. That's one thing that we said we wanted to do, and we were able to do that now. We're starting that, so we thank God for that. And all those people online who support the ministry, we thank you for that. We'll go ahead and dive right in. We'll continue to talk about our study we've been doing the last couple of weeks that we've been talking about is Bible contradictions. One of the main things that we hang our head on is what we should hang our head on as far as what God, as far as God is concerned, is 2 Timothy 2:15. You know, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And there's divisions that we must make in order to get the benefit out of God's word that He desires for us to have. If you do not rightly divide your Bible, when we say rightly divide your Bible, when Paul says to rightly divide the word of truth, notice he's not saying to rightly divide the teachers that are teaching the right thing, right, from the teachers that are teaching the wrong thing, okay? He's talking about rightly dividing the word of truth, which means that he's talking about this truth, that truth. All of God's word is true, but there's a division in it that we must make. A couple of the main divisions is dividing the nation of Israel, right, from the body of Christ. Law from grace, prophecy from mystery. When we make those divisions in God's word, we'll be able to gain the understanding and benefit that God desires for us to have. And so as we continue to go through this, we're going to see some Bible scriptures that seemingly contradict. And now you always use that word seemingly because if you rightly divide, they do not contradict. Because we know God is the best interpreter of himself, and we know he's the God that cannot lie, and he's not the author of confusion. So if the Bible confuses you, then that means you have not garnered the spiritual understanding of God's word that he desires for you to have. And so having said that, we'll get into it. The first thing I'm going to ask is circumcision necessary?
No.
Is circumcision necessary?
No.
All right, while we're pondering on that, go ahead and turn to Genesis 17. And I'm going to say a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you now for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for your love, your kindness, your truth, your understanding. We just thank you for who you are. Father God, we thank you for technology that we're able to get the word of God out, that we're able to stream, and that people are able to see and hear the word of truth rightly divided. We thank you for that now. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, dying on the cross for our sins and shedding his blood, being buried and raised again on the third day, that we may have salvation as a present possession. We thank you for that now. We thank you right now for life, health, and strength. We thank you for the things that we so often take for granted. We just thank you for that now. We ask you to continue to bless us, O God, strengthen us where we're weak. Build us up in our inner man, God. Help us not to conform to this world, but be renewed by the transformed by the renewing of our mind. We ask you to help us to be content in the situation where we find ourselves in. Father God, we can do nothing in and of ourselves, and we need you. And we thank you for that now. Touch those who are sick. Heal them according to your will. Touch those who are dealing with bereavement and loss of loved ones, loss of job, whatever the situation they may be going through. Help us to understand that your grace is all sufficient. And we thank you for that now. We ask you to bless this ministry as we go forward. Bless each individual under the sound of my voice, individually as well as collectively. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so Genesis 17, and I've been posing some questions. And we're going to see how the Bible may seemingly contradict to answer these questions. But we're going to break the scriptures down and get some understanding. So the question is circumcision necessary?
No.
No. We say no?
Are there different versions of circumcision?
What you mean?
Different forms of it. Circumcision of the heart.
Okay.
Physical circumcision.
Good. Okay. Now, so the key question is circumcision necessary? The answer is yes. Okay. Now, what we have to find out, just like we were talking about when we did the baptism study, just like we had to find out about that, is baptism necessary for salvation? Most people will say no. But the spiritual baptism is a requirement, just as for us today, just as the water was a requirement for them back here. Okay, so now, is circumcision necessary? And we're going to see this. Genesis 17, look at verse, let's start at verse 10. This is my what?
Covenant,
okay? Now, we understand a covenant is an agreement between two parties, okay? This is a covenant that God gave to Abraham, the Abrahamic covenant according to Scripture, okay? Now, when we understand how to rightly divide, the first sign that should go off is this term covenant, okay? Because when you get to Ephesians 2 and 11, Paul says that we're strangers from any covenants of promise, or any commonwealth of Israel, okay? So we ought to know that this has nothing to do with us just based on the term covenant, okay? I was looking at something, one of these preachers, you guys know I don't like to tell the names, but I was looking at one of these famous preachers, and he had a rapper on his broadcast, okay? And he was talking to the rapper. They were talking about God, and the rapper had been to jail, and he was going through, and he said that he was asking about salvation. The preacher was asking the rapper about salvation, and the guy said, "I've always believed in God. I believe, you know, I just always believed in God." And so this person, this pastor, told him that, "Have you ever confessed in public?" You know, and he said, and the guy was like, "Well, I've confessed to God, but not in public." And he said, "Okay, just repeat this prayer after me. We're going to have a public moment of salvation." And he said, "Just repeat this prayer after me." And he didn't mention anything about belief in the death, burial, and resurrection. But he was saying a whole bunch of stuff that, you know, sounded good. And then after that, as if his prayer or as if his belief in God was not enough, he said, "I'm going to give you this letter of, it's a covenant of grace." Okay, so he gave me a covenant of grace letter signed by this pastor. And then he went through and said some things as far as how he's covenanted with grace. And he's in this covenant of grace. And he signed it and gave it to him. And, you know, that was the end of the show. And I was reading I like to read the comments. And everybody was commenting, "Oh, thank God he's saved." And, you know, blah, blah. And he got to keep the covenant of grace and all of this stuff that sounds good. But when you really go to the details of that, first of all, it's no such thing as a covenant of grace, okay? That's not even in Scripture. Now, Israel's covenant, okay, will be a gracious covenant because God will do what for them out here that they couldn't do over here? He's going to cause them to keep his commandments. So that covenant to them is going to be a gracious covenant. But there's no such term today as a covenant of grace, okay? And again, people like to use biblical words, which they're sincere, but they're just sincerely wrong, okay? I have every idea to believe that this person was sincere about what he was saying. He just was sincerely wrong, okay? Because being under a grace covenant and, you know, not even believing in the right things, okay? Because every man believes in something, okay? Every man has faith. Every church-going person has faith, okay? The question and the issue is faith in what? Okay, faith in a covenant over here or faith in the law doesn't save anybody today. So just because I say I believe in God, that doesn't save anybody. Okay, the devil believes in God. Okay, and so that's what we're going to see. So Genesis 17, look at verse 10. "This is my covenant which ye shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee. Every man child among you shall be what?
Circumcised.
And ye shall circumcise the what?
Flesh.
The flesh of your foreskin, and in it shall be a token of the covenant between me and you. And he that is 8 days old shall be circumcised among you, every man child in your generations. He that is born in the house or bought with the money or of any stranger which is not of thy seed, he that is born in thy house and he that is bought with thy money must needs be circumcised. And my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting what?"
Covenant.
Okay, now look at verse 14. Because notice now, with the covenants and the way God dealt with the nation of Israel, it was always a what? Conditional statement. Because they God operated with them based on a short account system. If they did this, you would get this. If they didn't, there was a consequence. So many times people like to take the promises of Israel, right, reading somebody else's mail, but they don't want to take the if they don't do it, okay? They'll take these promises, and when it comes to the curses, oh, Jesus died to be a curse for us. We don't take the curses. But they take the promises, though, right? And so we see here, look at verse 14. And the uncircumcised man-child, whose flesh of his foreskin is not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from his who? From his people. He hath broken my what? My covenant. Right? So is the circumcision necessary according to this verse here? Absolutely. Right? But this, notice the covenant was where? In their what? Flesh. The cutting off of the foreskin. Okay? Now, go to Colossians. Before that, go to Galatians first. Go to Galatians. Galatians chapter number 5. Galatians chapter number 5. Because we just read that these individuals had to be circumcised, or if they were not, their souls would be cut off because they had broken a covenant. Look at this, Galatians 5, and look at verse 2. Look at verse 1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Right? Look at verse 2. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be what?
Circumcised,
Christ shall profit you what?
Nothing.
Now, is this verse in direct opposition to the verse we just read in Genesis? Yes. Right? So how do we make these verses coincide? We have to rightly divide the word of truth. These are Bible contradictions that seemingly contradict if you don't right divide. One is telling me if I'm circumcised, it's not going to profit me anything. The other verse is saying if I don't get circumcised, my soul is going to be cut off. Right? Look at this. Look at verse 3. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the what? The whole law. He's a debtor to the whole law. Now, in order to please God, was there righteousness in the law?
Yes.
So in order to please God, you had to do what?
Follow the law,
but follow it what? Perfectly. Mm-hmm. Because if you broke one law, you've what? Offended in all of it. Okay? So notice now, I tell to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to the whole law. Look at verse 4. Christ is become of what?
No effect unto you.
Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from what?
Grace.
You're fallen from grace. Now, is this saying you're fallen from, you lose your salvation? No, it's just saying that under grace and the benefits that it provides and the liberty that it provides, right, you've fallen from that.
Those two can't coincide.
You've fallen from that, right? And so what happens is, it's either I'm under the law or I'm under grace, all right? And we're under grace today. We're not under the law. Sin has no dominion over us. So we're not under the law, but we're under grace. Romans 6:14, right? And so this is what we see. Now, so we see the difference here between the circumcision, and there is a circumcision of the heart. Go to Colossians 2. Go to Colossians 2.
Verse 11.
Is it verse 11? What I want? Yes, verse 11. Thank you. Colossians 2, verse 11. Well, let's read verse 10. And ye are what? Complete in him, okay? Which is the head of all principality and power. The him is who? Christ, right? Look at verse 11. And whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without what? Hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of who?
Christ.
Christ, buried with him in baptism, wherein ye also are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God who had raised him from the what? From the dead. Right? Go to Philippians chapter 3. Right? So understand this now. Is circumcision necessary? The answer is yes. Okay? Now, when you rightly divide, you understand that there was a circumcision of the flesh that was necessary for them for over in this dispensation, but there's a circumcision for us that's necessary also, but for this dispensation, okay? God deals with men differently according to the dispensation. He has different sets of instructions for righteousness, all right? Look at Philippians chapter 3. Look at verse 2. Beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the concision. For we are the what?
Circumcision.
Which worship God in the spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the what?
Flesh.
In the flesh. But this circumcision over here in Genesis was a circumcision of the what?
Flesh.
Which was a covenant between God and them. Right? And it had to be done. But circumcision of the flesh today will profit you nothing. It will profit you nothing, all right? Now, is there is the law for a righteous man?
No. It was then.
Huh?
Is that a trick question? They're all trick
questions. No, the law is not for the righteous.
Is the law for a righteous man?
No.
No.
Find out. Answer, Alex.
All right, no?
No.
All right, now, go to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. So, is the law for righteous men?
No.
Right? Matthew 5. Now, and the first three things we need to ask ourselves when studying the Bible is who wrote the book, right? To whom were they writing, the audience, and then what dispensation were they writing, okay? This is Matthew here. This is Jesus speaking, and he's speaking to his disciples here. Look what he tells them. Think not that I am come to do what?
Destroy.
Destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to do
17,
what?
5 and 17.
But to fulfill, right? Matthew 5 and 17. So he says, think not that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to what?
Fulfill.
What does fulfill mean?
Obey.
To obey. What else?
Complete.
To complete. Right? So if Christ came to complete the law, and if we're in Christ, then that means we're what? We're complete. We just read that Colossians 2:10. Right? But notice this, because people will come to this verse and say, listen, after being saved, we got to go back and keep the law. Okay, look at this. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be what?
Fulfilled.
See, so he was saying at this time, they were not to not keep the law.
Yeah, and the preterist point of view is that hasn't happened yet.
Exactly, exactly. So that's how they get away with making you think you got to still keep the law, okay?
They're saying that heaven and earth hasn't passed away.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what they're saying, right? Now, we know better, okay? Because we understand, and this is the thing about people. When Christ said it is finished, that's exactly what he meant, okay? It is finished, right? The way to God is through Christ. And the fact that he died, he fulfilled the law by keeping it perfectly, okay? He fulfilled it, right? He fulfilled those things, right? Now, at this time, though, right, Jesus was teaching them about things that they should have done at this time, okay? He did not come to destroy it, but to fulfill. And even at this time, he was telling them, listen, in your law it says thou should not kill. But I'm here to tell you, because what he did was he fortified the law, which means he strengthened it. He says, your word says thou should not kill, but I'm telling you, if you have if you're angry at your brother without a fault, it's the same thing. He says, thou shalt not commit adultery. But if you lusted upon a woman in your mind, you've already committed it. Most people, but so what he was doing is strengthening it, because he was checking the what? The heart. See, God is the only one that can see the heart. Right? You don't know if a person is truly saved. You can determine it based on what they say, if they know the gospel of their salvation. But nobody truly knows a person's heart except for God. Right?
And Pastor, all the more reason why the church, see, we know what we know because of progressive revelation, and the Bible is complete. But at this time, mm-hmm. we have to always put ourselves at that time.
Exactly.
To make sure that we get the full
understanding of the people at that time. Exactly. At that time. Because at that time, and most people, they anticipate revelation. Which means they anticipate that these people back then know what we know now, and that's impossible because they didn't have a Bible necessarily. Okay, that this time they had the law to be going around, but they didn't have a completed Bible. Nobody was sitting there saying, "Turn the second this."
They didn't know a lot of stuff in their day, even though Christ proclaimed it.
Luke exactly.
18:34.
Yep. They didn't know a lot of things right at that time. There's still a lot of things at this time with the completion of his word that we still don't know. Okay, so understand that, right? So now, but this is telling us here that the law at this time was righteous until the person who could keep it became righteous, but it was up until a certain time till what he what fulfilled it. Okay, so all up until the time he fulfilled it, everybody was under to do what? Keep it. They were under that law. Now go to 1 Timothy. Because it's the law for a righteous man. Once we're made righteous, okay, are we to go back and keep the law?
No.
All right, look at 1 Timothy.
What's the one that said Christ died? What did it say? If righteousness is by the law, Christ died in vain.
Yeah, I'm going to get to that one. Yeah. Look at 1 Timothy 1. Not 1. Yeah. 1 and verse 7. This is most teachers today, right? 1 Timothy 1, verse 7. We have it?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Desiring to be teachers of the what?
Law.
Desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they what? Affirm. Right? Anybody teaching the law today don't know, they don't understand what they're saying, or they don't know even what they affirm to say. Right? And you have a lot of people that talk about, because we used to do in our old church, about an affirmation. Right? They're affirming what they believe. And they say it every Sunday. And they're wrong every Sunday. Okay? And they're affirming what they believe. And this is what I'm saying. And this is serious. I presented this to my pastor. I said, listen, my old pastor, I said, listen, there's something wrong in what we affirm to believe. And that is that's a huge problem. If I affirm to believe something is wrong, that he didn't think it was that big of a deal. That is a huge problem. If I'm affirming to believe something that is wrong, that is huge, right? What a person believes is who they are. Whether you believe in the right or wrong thing, that's who you are, okay? So if we're saying to be Christians and we're saying to follow Christ and to follow God, and when you're being shown in Scripture where you're wrong, that is a big deal. Okay? That's a big deal. But notice this now, verse 8. But we know that the law is what?
Good.
It is good, okay? If you can keep it. The problem is the strength of sin is the what?
Law.
Is the law. It was not made to make you righteous. Because God knew that you could not keep it. So why is it that now all of a sudden you're saved and people say, now that we have the Spirit in us, we can keep it? Good luck with that. Look at verse 8. But we know that the law is good if a man, what?
Use lawfully.
How do I use the law lawfully?
Good question.
How do I use the law lawfully?
You use it to somebody that's,
Before you answer, what is the purpose of the law?
To show our need for Christ,
show our imperfections, show our sin. So how can we use that lawfully?
Revelation 21:8
is a good one. Okay, Revelation 21:8. All liars shall have their part in the lake of fire. Okay, so now you ask the person, do you fit in this category? Have you ever told a lie? If they answer no, they just put themselves in that category, okay? Because they just lied, All right. So now it says all liars will have their part in the lake of fire. Mm-hmm. Right. That's how you use the law lawfully. You use the law because you ask people, are you doing this? Are you doing this? Are you keeping that? Are you doing this? Right. If they answer yes to everything, again, they just put themselves in the category. All right. So now that you're in this category, okay, now you've used the law lawfully because you've pointed out to the person you're in need of a savior.
Amen.
Because if you broke it once, that's it. And now you're in need of a savior. So that's how, what, that was the purpose of the law. Right now, look at verse 9. Knowing this, that the law is not made for a what?
Righteous man.
For a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly, for sinners, it goes all the way down. Right? But Christ is our righteousness. Right? God, for he who knew no sin, God gave him sin, right? So that we can be made the righteousness of God in him. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Right? See, so if we're righteous, then what do you mean I have to keep the law in order to stay saved afterwards? When the law is not even made, I'm righteous now. That's just like saying, listen, after I get my high school diploma, a college degree, I got to go back to the second grade. That sounds silly. Why in the world would you put me back under the law when it was not made for a righteous man and I'm now righteous?
Jesus.
You see that? And so understand is that, was there a righteousness in the law?
Yes.
For the people who can keep it. Right? Look at this. Go to Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2, verse 21. Galatians 2, look at verse 21. I do not what?
Frustrated.
I do not frustrate the grace of God. We can frustrate God's grace. People do it all the time. Because you're trying to work for something that God has already given to you for free. That frustrates him, okay? I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the what? The law, then Christ is what?
Dead.
And listen, if you could keep the law and be righteous on your own, what was the purpose of Christ coming?
Jesus.
If you could do it by keeping the law, what in the world do you believe in Christ for? Right? You might as well use some of my blood. Yeah, because what is the purpose of Christ's blood being shed if you could do it on your own?
If the Old Testament saints, none of them could keep the law,
uh-huh.
Well, how are they saved if they couldn't keep it?
Exactly. And the key is this. They were not saved, but they were justified. Okay? There's a difference between justification and salvation. Justification means to be declared righteous. Okay, salvation just means to be deliverance is what salvation is. Okay, now, what are we saved from today?
God's wrath.
God's wrath, okay? When a person, to say that we're saved today, we're saved from the wrath of God, Romans 5:9, okay? That's what we're saved from. These people back here weren't saved from the wrath of God because it was Jacob's trouble. They had to go through it. Now, when they kept it, when they provided the animal sacrifices, which again was an example of the shed blood of Christ on the cross, that justified them, which means that they were now in right standing before God based on the sacrifices that they made. All right? Uh-huh. And so now, God knew, Romans chapter 3, verse 25, it says God had propitiation in the blood of Christ for the forbearance of sins that were past. Okay, so everything back here, God put it on credit, basically. When they sacrificed those animals, Hebrews 10:4, the blood of bulls and goats couldn't take away sin. God knew that. They didn't. They only knew what God told them to do. So he allowed them to provide the animal sacrifices because he knew that this blood on the cross would cover all of these sins back here. You see? So they were justified. But they were not saved, okay? Justification back here is not salvation. Now, justification for us in this dispensation is salvation.
So the only people that names won't be written in the book in the great white throne, as far as out there, is the people that didn't keep the law.
It's the people that didn't keep it and didn't offer the proper sacrifice, okay?
Praise
now,
God.
Exactly. Now, Paul says that, listen, I was a Pharisee of the Pharisee. I kept the whole law. Now, what is he saying? Did he never break it? No. He offered the proper sacrifice, okay? Because the proper sacrifice would mean that faith had to work back here, right? So if I had faith in God, then if I broke the law, I would do something. I would do the requirement in order to still be in right standing with God. Faith would cause me to offer the sacrifice, okay? And so that's what it was back here. So they were justified back here, but they were not eternally saved. That's why back here and in this dispensation over here, they could lose salvation because technically they never received it, right? God is going to give them a new covenant to when he will take away the sins of Israel. That is when they'll be saved, okay? That's what the scriptures talk about, right? Now,
what's the purpose of them being saved after Jacob's trouble?
What's that?
What would be the purpose of them being saved after Jacob's trouble?
Because it would be their promise. Because remember now, their promise of salvation for them was land, and then for these folks here, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, was the coming kingdom.
Yeah,
okay,
they won't be excluded from the wrath, though.
Yeah, no, they won't be excluded from the wrath. The wrath is something because they broke his covenant, right? Because that's why it's called Jeremiah 30:7 calls it Jacob's trouble.
So is his punishment on them not gracious in that they didn't have grace? So he still has to uphold his if you do, if you don't?
Yeah, he's still upholding that. And the thing about it is this. Their salvation does not come without a testing, right? When Peter talks about, 1 Peter, the trial of your faith, when somebody is on trial, what does that mean? They're facing what?
Punishment,
time, right? When somebody's on trial today, I got a trial, you know exactly they're either about to go to jail or they're about to be exonerated, okay? Or exhumed of all charges, okay? So the trial of their faith, right? The testing, when Peter says, Yeah, the trial of your faith, but when he also says the punishment of God starts in the household of God first, uh-huh. And people always use that today, it's talking about out here. That punishment is going to start here. The wrath for those people who believe in God, God is going to keep them out of that, right? And a perfect example of that is Noah. Right? A type and shadow of that is Noah. Did Noah go through the flood?
Yeah.
But he also what? Made it out of the flood, okay? Israel, they're going to go through. Those people that believe in Christ, right, and continue to follow Christ at this time, they're going to make it through the tribulation.
So are they
going
to get some kind of enlightenment that what's happening is seen from the Bible being manifested in that day? And I only ask that because the people who that wrath was reserved for, they're no longer
exactly. And what happens is they're still the descendants of these people here.
So that's the third and fourth generation.
Exactly. Yeah. And so going back to that, so the justification back here was not permanent salvation for them. All right. Most people confuse the two, all right? Because they'll come over here to read Paul's epistles and see that our justification equals salvation, because we're saved from the wrath to come. But that's only in this dispensation. You have to rightly divide that. Because justification for them was not permanent salvation. Okay?
They would have immediate atonement. Then.
They would have immediate atonement, which they don't have the immediate atonement, right? They're going to have a national day of atonement. Right? Everything that they did back here, the sacrifice, all of that was a symbol to point to Christ. Which is why they should have knew him when he came. Because everything they did for all this long period of time was just, you know, they should have known, right? And even I played ball, and an example, you practice all week, and the coach shows you plays all week. And the game, when they run that play, if you miss it, the coach is livid, right? Because we practice this play all week, and you come in the game and you miss it, okay? I've never done that, not me, okay? but you practice hard all week and you come to the game and they give you what you practice and you mess it up. They practice this all the feast days, when the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Pentecost, all of these things was a kind of dress rehearsal. So when Christ came, they would, because all of that pointed to him. But yet they still didn't know, right? And so you see this here, that the righteousness of God is not found in the law. But was it ever? Was the righteousness ever found in the law?
Yes.
Go to Deuteronomy. Go to Deuteronomy 6:25, right? Does righteousness come by the law? Now, most people today will say, well, righteousness never came by the law because they read Paul's epistles. But these people back here didn't have Paul's epistles. Mm-hmm. Okay? We can say now that no the law should not justify any flesh. Okay? Right? You can say that now because you have Paul's epistles and we're living in the dispensation in which Paul was talking about. But these people didn't have that. These people didn't have Paul's epistles back here. There was a type of righteousness in the law. Okay? Wow. Look at this. Deuteronomy 6, verse 25. Let's start at verse 24. Deuteronomy 6, verse 24. Does righteousness come by the law? And the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes to fear the Lord our God for our good always, that he might preserve us alive as it is at this day. And it shall be our what?
Righteousness.
Here we go. If, okay, it's always a conditional statement with them because this is how God dealt with them. So it shall be our righteousness if what? If we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God, as he hath what?
Commanded us.
So was there righteousness in the law?
Yes.
Absolutely. Right? Now, come over to Romans chapter 3, chapter 10.
Can I read Luke 1, 6 on the way?
Yeah, go ahead.
It says, and they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless.
There you go. And that is talking about John's mother. Right? And father. Right? Is Luke 1?
Yes.
Elizabeth
and the... Yeah. All right. Yeah. And they were righteous. And notice they were righteous because they what?
Kept
the statutes. They walked in the statutes of God. Okay? So again, there was a righteousness found in the law if a person could keep it. All right? Romans 10. And the question is the law, or does the righteousness come by the law? We saw that in this time it did, okay? But look over here in Romans chapter 10. Let's start at verse 3. Let's start at verse 2. Paul, for I bear them record. Paul is talking about Israel here. Well, let's just start at verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for who?
Israel
is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to what?
Knowledge.
See, most people in church today in religion, they have a zeal. They go to church. They want to serve God. They want to praise God. They want to worship God. But it's not according to knowledge, right? See, so most people are sincere in their actions, okay, but sincerely wrong, right? And because they're sincerely wrong and only have a zeal, let's read verse 3. This is what happens. Verse 3 starts off with the word what?
Four,
which means further explanation. Paul is going to further explain why those people that have zeal, not according to knowledge, this is what they do. For they've been ignorant, just not knowing, of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own what?
Righteousness.
Have not submitted themselves unto the what? Righteousness of God. See, when you think that you're doing something for God, what you're actually doing is submitting to your own righteousness. And not submitting to the righteousness of God. Who is a perfect example of that?
T.J.
Oh, wow. No, somebody, not anybody, somebody in the Bible.
Paul.
Exactly, Paul. Saul was considering the killing Christians. He was tying them up. He thought that he was doing the right thing. But he went about to do what? He was establishing his own righteousness. He was killing you if you didn't keep the law. But he was establishing his own righteousness. Now, can we not say and agree that he had a zeal?
Yeah.
Well, he definitely had a zeal. He was willing to take you out. He definitely had a great zeal for God because he was doing that on behalf of God. So he thought, okay? But God touched him, right? And so you have a righteousness that was found in the law, right? Now, look at verse 4. It starts off with what?
Four.
Further explanation, okay? For Christ is the end of the law to everyone that believeth.
For righteousness.
Here we go. Don't miss those key words, right? That's why we have our Bibles open. For Christ is the end of the law for what?
Righteousness.
For righteousness. Because we just read in Deuteronomy 6:25, for it would be our what? Righteousness if we did all of these things. Mm. Right? So we no longer have to do all these things today when you rightly divide. Why? Because Christ is the end of the law for what? Righteousness to everyone that believeth. Because remember we read in Matthew 5, 17 and 18 now that Christ did not come to destroy the law but to what?
Fulfill.
So now that it's been fulfilled, he's the end of the law for righteousness. He's already met God's standard for righteousness because he was able to keep the whole law what? Perfectly.
Amen.
So we don't have to try to keep the law to stay saved, to get saved, to be right. That all of that's done with. It's to them that what? Believe. Right? Now, are we to follow the law? Right? Go to Matthew 23. Are we dead to the law or should we follow it? Because most people say, listen, I follow Jesus. I don't follow Paul. I follow Jesus. Well, do you really follow what he said? Okay? And now most of the times, I when people say that, I go to the scripture where Jesus was talking, and Jesus says, listen, if any man asks you of anything, you ought to give it to him. And so I ask people, now, do you believe that verse? And they say, yeah. I said, well, I need a $10,000 cashier's check tomorrow. Now, if you follow Jesus, he said, you give to any man that asks of you. That's exactly what the verse says. So if you truly follow him, then you need to write me this cashier's check. Right? See, because if they truly follow him, then that's exactly what it says. And I even go a little step further. I said, you can start by selling this computer that you're typing to me on to get you started. Right? But they, that's not what it's saying. That's exactly what it's saying. Because remember, there's no wiggle room in the law.
Amen.
There wasn't no wiggle room. You either did it or you didn't. There was no wiggle room that people tried to. See, people use grace now and bring it back over here. There was no wiggle room in that law. That was not grace. It was law. If you did it, you get this. If you did it, there was no saying, well, you could do it. Just do it better the next time. Not with the law. There was no grace involved in the law because it was not made to make you righteous. Okay, look at this. What did I say? Matthew 23, let's start at verse 1. Because are we dead to the law or should we follow it? Because if I follow Jesus, then that means I have to follow everything Jesus says, right? All right, let's see. Look at 23, verse 1. Then spake Jesus to the multitude and to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in who?
Moses'
seat. And we know Moses was the giver of what?
The law.
Of the law. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and what?
Do.
But do not ye after their works, for they say and what?
Do not.
So Jesus is telling them to do what the people in Moses' seat tell you to do. What were the people in Moses' seat telling you to do?
Keep the law.
So if you're truly following Jesus to the T as you say you are, then don't be telling me, well, we're not under no law, we're under grace. That ain't what Jesus is saying. Right? You have to rightly divide the word of truth. You can't take this information right here, substitute grace in the meaning of it. Grace was not in the meaning of when Jesus was talking right here. Right? That was not in the meaning. Now, go to Romans chapter 7.
And while you're going there, Pastor, he clearly is speaking to his disciples.
Yep. Yeah.
Even when he healed people and things like that, he said, go do after the manner of Moses.
Yeah, absolutely. Right? So if Jesus was here today, he would tell you to go do what Paul is telling you to do. Because that is the message of God's righteousness for today. Jesus says in John 8, obey whom I send thee. To disobey the person that Christ sent is to disobey him. Right? Back here, they disrespected Moses and God. The scripture says they went against Moses and God because Moses was the spokesperson for God here. Nobody ever questions the fact all of these people back here followed Moses, and Moses was a great figure back here, the spokesman for God. The soon as you mentioned Paul, it's such a big deal. These people followed Moses over here. Right, as Paul says, follow me as I am a follower of Christ. These people followed Moses as he was a follower of God. Mm-hmm. But yet it's such a big problem over here.
Wow.
You see that? Look at Romans 7.
And he only wrote 5 books.
Yeah, Moses wrote 5. Paul wrote more than any person in the Bible. Right? Look at this. Romans 7. So the question is, are we dead to the law or should we follow it?
Dead.
Now, if I follow Jesus according to the red letters, then I should what? Follow the law. All right? Let's look at what this says. Romans 7, verse 3. Paul is using an example here of marriage. So then, let's just start at verse 1. Let's get the context. Romans 7, verse 1. Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that what?
Know the law.
So who's the audience he's speaking to?
Israel.
Right? These Jews here that would have known the law. Because remember, early in Paul's ministry, his ministry was to the who first?
Gentile.
To the Jew first. Right? So there's a lot of times where Paul will let you know specifically who he's talking to. Because in Romans chapter 2, verse 14, Paul says, for the Gentiles who have not the law. The Gentiles did not have the law.
So that dispels that Gentiles are dispersed Jews.
Exactly. Yep, those folks who say that. You're absolutely right, right? The Gentiles had not the law, okay? So understand this now. When Paul is talking to make a perfect example, he's telling you exactly who he's talking to. Psalms 147, 19 and 20 says, for I have not dealt so with any other nation. I have not given my statutes and judgments to any other nation. You see that? He only gave the law to Israel. So if Paul is, and a parenthetical statement means that it just adds clarity to the sentence. All right? So he's letting you know, that's why it's in parentheses, who he's talking to them that knew the law. And this is a perfect example of these Jews who would have been following Jesus or who would have been listening and trying to keep the law, Paul is going to open up their understanding here. So he's saying, for I speak to them that know the law, how that the law had dominion over a man as long as he what? Liveth. That's why Romans 6:14 starts up with, for sin shall have no more dominion over you. For you're not under the law, you're under what? Grace. Okay, look at this. For the woman which hath an husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as he liveth. To death do us part, right? But if the husband be dead, she is loose from the law of her husband.
Wow.
You see that? Look at verse 3. So then, if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. Look at this now. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that what?
Law.
So that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. See, Paul is giving them an example of the law. Listen, under this covenant, under this marriage over here, you were required to keep the law. But now that Christ has come and died on the cross, okay, he's freed you from this covenant of keeping the law.
Amen.
You see that? We are not to follow the law. We are to follow Christ now during this dispensation of grace. And the way to do that is to understand the gospel of Christ, the gospel of the grace of God. That's how you follow Jesus today. You see that? let me see. Now, do we need a temple to worship in or no?
No.
No.
You sure?
No, our bodies are the temple.
Sure.
Our bodies are the temple.
Huh?
Our bodies are the temple.
Okay. What does that mean?
That spirit that was in the temple resides in me.
Thank you.
Okay, okay. Y'all study your Bibles a little bit. Okay, okay. All right, now, let's go to this. Go to Acts 2. We're going to see this. Because a lot of the things that they performed had to be performed where?
In the temple.
In the temple. Tithing is one of them. Okay? And so if there's no temple, there's no requirement to do the things that can only be done in the temple. Watch this now. The temple was very important in this particular dispensation over here. The temple was very important. Acts 46. Yeah, Acts 2, I think it's 46.
It talks about the temple.
Yeah. Yeah, that's my point.
Probably it.
Let's go to verse 42. I'm going to explain this just a little bit because it speaks on it. I like to get the context. 46 is what I want. Yeah, that's it. But I want to read 42. And they, now who is they here?
They,
who did they be here?
The Jews.
Yeah, that little flock, or the house of Israel, because that's who Peter was addressing. When people go to the Pentecostal religion, they go to Acts 2, this is when the church began. No, there was only Jews there. When Peter addressed these people, Acts 2, 22, Acts 2, 36, he says, let the house of Israel know. Okay, so that they are the house of Israel, not any Gentiles, not anybody today, okay? They continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. What doctrine would that have been that the apostles had?
The gospel of the kingdom.
The coming kingdom, right? The Lord's Prayer, you know, that people love to sing today. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What are you praying that prayer for? And as a matter of fact, Jesus was just telling his disciples, this is the manner after which you should pray. He wasn't telling them that's what they should be saying anyway. Okay, he said, this is the manner after which you should pray. You should be praying about things that are going to come for you. That's their hope, the coming kingdom. So they should have prayed for that. That's not our hope, right? Look at this. Doctrine of fellowship and breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things in what?
Common.
Right? They had all things in common. Paul, Ephesians 2:11, we're strangers from the commonwealth of Israel. Why would Paul say the commonwealth of Israel? Look at verse 45. Because 44 tells you they had all things where? In common. Look at verse 45. And sold their
possessions
and goods and parted them to all men as every man had what?
Need.
Now, the thing about this is the commonwealth means they had everything in what? Common. And the apostles would divvy it out as they saw need. Now, if the church or the people who think that they're spiritual Israel and think that the body of Christ started at this time, why does not everybody in the church give everything to the pastor? That's what this verse is saying. Oh, you don't trust him that much. That's what it is. Okay, you trust him a little bit, but you don't trust him enough to have everything in common. Because notice that they divvied it out to all men as every man had what?
Need.
Okay? They can only, remember now, they had the Holy Ghost had just what? Came upon them. Okay? Now, your pastor say he has the Spirit, but do you trust him to divvy this thing out evenly? Or do you trust him to pocket a little bit for himself? Right? See, so understand now, if you're going to do things according to this program, then you need to do it. And this is one of them, to have a common wealth. Okay, we're strangers from the commonwealth because the only people who were there at this time is who?
Jews.
Israel, Jews. So that's why the Gentiles, we're strangers, Paul says, from the commonwealth of Israel. We're not a part of this. Look at verse 46. And they continuing daily with one accord in the what?
Temple.
This was a requirement, okay? And breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, okay? Now, so the question then becomes, do we need a temple?
No.
Looks like they needed one there.
They did.
Okay,
they
so did. Now, that's what we have to do. We have to rightly divide the word of truth. Now, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Look at verse 16. First Corinthians 3, verse 16. Know ye not that ye, which is plural for members of the body, are the what?
Temple of God.
So now notice now, the temple has now shifted from a particular building to a person. Mm. You see that? So when people say, listen, come on, are you going to go to church with me? A good reply to really mess them up would be, I am the church. I am the church. Right? Now they're gonna look at you crazy. Now you're some kind of narcissistic, you're in a cult and all this other stuff. But really, we are the temple of God. Because God does not dwell in temples made with hands. Okay? Even when they come and when God comes back, He says there's going to be no need for light. He is the temple and the light. Okay? So understand that it says, know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. Not just come upon you, like the day of Pentecost, but it what? Dwelleth in you. There's a difference. Because it came upon them for the purpose of God's intended purpose at that time. But the Holy Ghost now indwells in us today. There's a difference. Because Peter, still, when the Holy Ghost fell upon him, right, he had to be withstood to the face by Paul. When the Spirit came upon them for the work of the Acts 2 to Acts 7, right, Peter was doing everything right.
According to their election of grace, do they have, the little flock have somewhat of an atonement?
Yes, Because everybody at that time would have been justified for that purpose. So these people that believed in the program here, at the time God dispensed the dispensation of grace when he met with Paul, right, that enabled everybody at that time that was living, right, that's why they were able to go to the circumcision and Paul go to the heathen. You see that? Yeah. Look at, now that I said that, now that you brought that up, now, is salvation of the Jews or of the Gentiles?
When, at this time or not then?
Good question. All right. So now people will say, well, Jesus went to Gentiles and Jews. His message was for Gentiles and Jews. Right? And let's go to John 3:16. Because people will say, Jesus' message, because the book of Mark is written to the Gentiles. I say, huh? I said, now, I know where they got this from, because if you read a commentary, it'll tell you that. Okay? And so I know that because I've read it before. And so, where do you get that Mark is written to Gentiles? Okay, when you do the study, I've done this before, of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You notice that they all say similar things, because they all point to Christ from different perspectives: one king, one servant, one man, and one God. Okay, that's why you have the four faces that Daniel speaks about back here. The branch, the four times it uses the term branch in the Old Testament with capital B. All of these things point to Christ, just from a different perspective. Which a Jew reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John should have automatically known Christ was the Messiah.
Those are also, are they the synoptic gospels?
Yeah, the synoptic
so they
gospels.
They summarize.
Yep. And they summarize those things as they point. That's why you see, does every gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, have a genealogy?
No.
It doesn't?
No. I think John is the one that does.
Do they have the genealogy of Christ in all the Gospels?
No.
They don't. It doesn't. No.
Why wouldn't they, or why would they, based on your answer?
One depicts him as man, one is king, and one is servant.
There you go. And see, this is the reason, and this is what the Bible student, you have to ask yourself why you see these differences in Scripture. If they're all speaking about Christ from pretty much the same perspective, then why does one have a genealogy the other one doesn't? Matthew has the genealogy, but notice it says the son of David and the son of Abraham. Now, who came first, Abraham or David?
Abraham.
So why would Matthew, when it talks about the genealogy of Christ, put David before Abraham? You see that? So now, when you ask yourself these questions, Matthew represents him as king, okay? All right, now, Matthew represents him as king. When a person becomes king, like the president of our country, okay, when a person becomes king, wouldn't you want to know where he came from, the family that he came from, the lineage that he came from? You would want to know all of that, right? That's why all of you that run for presidents, if you don't want your business known, you better not run for president, okay? Because they want to know who your parents were, who their parents were, the history of they want to know all of that. And from as a king, you want to know who is his lineage, okay? Especially back in this time, because kings and dynasties were based on the lineage, okay? And so now David was to be a what?
King.
Abraham was promised what?
The land.
Okay, so now Matthew represents him as king, so he's going to be the son of David first, and then the son of Abraham, okay? That's why it says that, all right? John 3:16. People are going to go to this verse and say, listen, Jesus is talking to everybody, okay? And we all know this verse, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth on him
In him.
Oh, okay. Whoso believeth in him should not what?
Him.
But have everlasting what? Life. Now, why doesn't it say believe on him? Are we believing in Christ for salvation, or are we believing on him?
On him.
See, there's a difference in the terms. When Paul uses the 1 Timothy 1 and 16, he says that Christ in me first, to be the pattern after them which should follow, and to believe in on him for life everlasting. Because our gospel today is not just believing that Christ is the Son of God. That won't save anybody today. But you have to believe on his what? Word. It's the finished work of Christ by which we receive salvation. All right? It's not just him being born. Because everybody today, no matter what denomination, no matter what religion, knows about Christ. Whether they believe it or not, they at least know about it. Okay? And there's a difference between knowing about somebody and knowing them. All right? And so here, Jesus, this is just a proclamation of that Christ is going to come for the whole world. He was born. That was it. That meant he was specifically speaking to Gentiles, because go over one chapter, John chapter 4. And this will be the last one. John chapter 4, look at verse 22. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the who?
The Jews.
Well, hold on now. He just said in John 3:16 that he came for the whole world, right? But here he's telling you one chapter over. Salvation is of the Jews. Because at this time, right, could a Gentile be justified back at this time?
Yes.
By way of what?
Proselyte,
converting to the law, or by way of Abraham and covenant, which means they had to bless Israel. Either way, they had to go through who? Israel. That's why Paul says there's only one mediator today between God and man. Were the Gentiles to be saved through Israel's rise or through their fall?
Their fall.
Huh?
Gentiles through their fall.
Today.
Yeah, today.
But back here, Gentile was saved through Israel's what? Rise.
So will it be out
here? Right? Because in order to get to God back here, he always went through what? One nation, Israel. So that's why Jesus says in Matthew 15, it is not meet for me to take the children's bread and give it to the dogs. Right? Because a Gentile could not be blessed until Israel was blessed back here. Matthew 10, 5 and 6. Right? But today, every man is on the same plane regardless of nationality. Right? Because there's only one mediator today between God and man, and that's who? That's Christ.
Amen.
Because at this time, Jesus came for those who were under the law. Okay, now if a Gentile played their part, like the woman when he told that to, she had faith calling him thou son of David, she understood her place, because she said even the lapdog catches the crumbs that fall from the master's table. She put herself in her place before him.
Amen.
You see that? And because of that, and her faith, he cried, oh woman, right? And so that's what happened. So salvation at this time was of the Jews, because that's who Jesus came for. But thank God for his grace.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
And we can receive salvation by no works of our own today.
Amen.
But by simple belief on the work, finished work of Christ.
Amen.
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 All minds and hearts clear?
Amen.
Again, thank you. Thank you again for Brother Chuck, who came out with us. Let's give him a hand. We thank God for him coming out. He was found us online, and he gave me a call, and we met up at the Panera Bread over there 1 week. And we were talking, and we had a good conversation. He said he was going to come check us out. So he came tonight. Thank God for him coming. And so we'll go from there. We thank God for you. Thank God for all of you that are here tonight. And we'll pick back up on Sunday. We'll pick back up on Sunday. There's still a lot more contradictions that we have to point out. That we need to point out in order for people to understand what it means to rightly divide the word.
This lesson would be good for a sheep.
For who?
For our sheets, like to have the scriptures versus the scriptures for contradictions.
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay.
You
go step up and
You got it already.
I have a list, but I don't have it. What he's talking about is to kind of have it side by side.
Exactly. Like
so
this.
We go through. Yeah.
You have one.
Yeah, I have one with just a list of things though. I'll try to cover.
I'll take that list. That's fine.
Okay. And I'll do that.
There's a pamphlet out there that says Bible contradictions too.
Okay. All right. right. And so we'll get that done. All right. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you now for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for your love, your kindness, your understanding. Father God, we thank you for this time. You said in your word that we are to redeem the time for the days of evil. So we thank you for this time of worship, this time of fellowship, this time of understanding. Your word says about all thy getting, get an understanding. So we thank you for understanding of your word, Father God. We ask that you continue to bless us, open up our spiritual eyes of understanding. Father God, help us to proclaim the mystery of the gospel of God to all those who are lost. We thank you right now. We pray for those who are lost in denominational religion. We ask you to open up their eyes, oh God, open up their hearts, that the scales may fall from their eyes, they may see the truth. Help them not to be ever learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Father God, we ask you to help us to be gentle and apt to teach, oh God, considering ourselves, oh God, as we go and approach other people. Help us to know that, Father God, it's you who will give them repentance to the knowledge of the truth, and it's them that may recover themselves from out of the snare of the devil, who has them captive at his will. We thank you right now. We ask you continue to help us to show charity, oh God. Help us to do all things in love. Help us to help our good not to be evil spoken of. We thank you for that now. We ask you continue to bless those who are sick. Heal them according to your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God.
Thank God.
Amen.
Amen. Oh.